Hey everybody, so I have a special surprise for you today. We have a guest speaker. His name is Dan O'Connor and he has been working in this industry for quite some time. So today's topic is why data quality? So data quality is something that you should plan for before you get into anything in information architecture. And collect as much data as possible because you never know what information you're going to need later down the line. Again, within reason, if you're collecting too much information, you can drag down your systems. You can collect data that doesn't matter or is going to be so outdated that it's not going to be pertinent. So there are some rules, you know, use your best judgment. And we will definitely go over some ways to decide what to capture in data collection. But Dan is going to be sharing with us a real-world example as to why you need good data for doing things like machine learning or doing any kind of business intelligence. So with that, let's go see what Dan has to say. So today we are going to be talking with Dan O'Connor, who I have known for quite some time. Really respect his LinkedIn post. So if you don't follow him, you should probably go and do that. And we're going to be talking about why does data quality matter? It is often overlooked, but it can really hurt what you're trying to do. So we're going to go through other ways of doing data quality. But right now, I thought it would be good to talk to Dan about some of his use cases so we can get an idea of what this looks like in the real world. So Dan, you want to introduce yourself?
Sure. Hi, I'm Dan O'Connor. I am the Director of Product Data Services at Verndale. We do content management implementations, and specifically my group does product information management and master data management tool implementations. We also look at strategic product data integration strategies and essentially how to develop governance processes around data as well.
So he's the guy with the plan with data with data governance, which is great. So Dan, you said that you had a good use case as to, you know, the trials and tribulations that can come awry when you don't have good data. You want to share that?
Sure. So we're working with a client that it was a charitable organization that what they did was they held events in different locations throughout the country. And they wanted to apply some machine learning against their database of clients and donations and locations. And we started taking a look at the data, and the first thing that we realized was there was no consistency, there was no normalized effort to be able to make the data actually work.
Dan, when you say actually work, so they were trying to do some machine learning. So why is consistent data so important to machine learning?
So when you're putting together an algorithm for machine learning, part of what you need is a consistent set of vernaculars to be able to tie data together to other data. Something as simple as white having a capital W versus a lowercase w, depending on how you build your algorithm, could be looked at as two completely different data points, even though they mean the same thing. Mm. This can occur based off of bad collection mechanisms, bad user interfaces. There's a lot of reasons why this could happen, but what it leads to is your algorithms being far less useful, providing far less information, and causing you to have to do more work to be able to cleanse the data, to be able to make your algorithm work properly. You can get around it by programming into your algorithm a bunch of workarounds and transformations, but really that's just bypassing the problem and creating more overhead on your machine learning algorithm rather than fixing the data problem.
And wouldn't you say that there's also a risk there? Because if you're not as familiar with machine learning techniques, and maybe you haven't done any machine learning on this data set, you might not realize that you're getting some false positives and some data analysis that is not correct and could lead you down a very bad path where you're making decisions that might be costly.
Right. And what generally ends up happening is you can spot those outliers fairly quickly, but remediating those outliers becomes chasing a rabbit. Mm-hmm. You find one, you fix that one, then you try it again and you find another, and you're over and over and over again, you're using the machine learning to show you where you have problems in your data, mm-hmm. as opposed to looking for problems in your data before you're doing the machine learning.
Yeah, I mean, we hear all the time the 80-20 rule, right? Like 80% of your time doing any data science is cleaning the data. I would actually argue, depending on what data you're looking at, especially if it's people and places like what you're talking about, it's probably more than 80% if you have a real problem with normalization.
And in our use case for that client, we actually couldn't do the machine learning because the data was so poor. Mm. So for an example, they had a client's database that was tied to their donations, the client table tied to their donations table, that wasn't even normalized to be able to tell when clients were showing up in multiple locations. So there was no way to be able to say this is how much an individual donor was actually donating to their cause. We couldn't equate locations to clients properly to see when they were showing up in multiple locations to figure out a marketing campaign around those multiple locations. All we could really do was see that year after year, as they moved locations, they had less donations. But beyond that, there wasn't an awful lot that could actually be assisted with without that data cleanse.
And that's why you ended up not being able to do the machine learning, because they didn't even have the data at all. It wasn't even just dirty data. It was just they didn't have the data at all to support their use case. Is that accurate?
That's accurate. And it comes from a lack of investment up front. Mm-hmm. To be able to do the right things from a data perspective. Your 80-20 rule, I argue with it a little bit. If you're spending 80% of your time doing data cleanse, it means that you're correcting the data after it's already been collected.
Good, yes, collection, exactly.
Good integration strategies, good user interfaces. Mm-hmm. Investing in those means you have to spend less time doing those data cleanse activities. But the other dirty, dark secret with data is after those cleanses are done, generally that's never pushed back against the original database it came from. And you have to repeat that activity over and over and over again.
Yeah. And I would say that you are the third person that I've had a similar conversation with, where cleaning data, making your data good or good again, it is not a set it and forget it activity. You have to, you know, kind of step back and say, okay, are we actually collecting the correct data to fit our use cases, right? In this case, they wanted to understand where they were going wrong with donations. What could they improve? Well, if they don't know some of the data that you're talking about, they can't do that. And if they do have that data and maybe they go in and they clean it, if they then don't go back, and this is what you just said, and fix what was already going on in the data set, they're just going to have to keep doing it over and over and over again.
And if you don't correct the process and the user interface and the data controls, you can put that data back into a database, but as soon as there's more data that's added to it, you're still having to re-cleanse. So yep. If you spent half the time that you spent on data cleanse fixing the process and the system issues that go along with that, the next time you had to do a data cleanse, you would be spending 10% of the time. Mm-hmm. And you'd be spending more time on getting actionable results out of the machine learning.
Yeah, algorithm. When I teach this concept to students and to new professionals, the analogy I use is you're addressing the symptoms and not the disease, right? Like you're going in and you're trying to make sure you give somebody, you know, cough medicine or, you know, cough drops because they have a cough, and you're not realizing maybe they have a cough because they're allergic to cats. You didn't ask those questions. You have no idea why the cough is there. You just keep applying something over and over again to the cough. And so I think this is an important thing for people to keep in mind, and why we need to talk more about data governance and data quality procedures, because it's really an upfront activity. If you can do it upfront, then you're going to have less headache later on.
And that data governance piece is a big piece, especially we deal with a lot of manufacturers. Mm-hmm. And understanding how data governance ties to data health is a difficult leap for a lot of companies to make, because they see it as an upfront cost. Those resources that go into that data governance process do not generate revenue. But what they do over the long term is they put the controls in place to reduce cost of doing everything else you want to do from a marketing perspective, from a BI perspective. Even though they are not a revenue generating unit, they save more money and give you more actionable results to be able to generate revenue than the cost of putting in those data governance elements in the first place.
So one thing I know that I have had to struggle with, and maybe you can tell me if you've heard this through your interactions, which is, what is the long-term ROI on this? Because you're saying that it's an upfront cost, right? And then we say, well, you're going to save money in the long run, right? So you don't have to keep cleaning the data. Another savings, which isn't monetary, is risk, right? In security, if you don't know what data you have and whether it's a personal piece of information or not, or can it be tied back to someone, you can be non-compliant with GDPR, right? The risk of having personal data that can't be forgotten. And, you know, if somebody comes in to audit you, you are totally screwed.
Yeah, and this is where the way that this is taught in a lot of schools when you go into data analytics programs is incorrect, because they tell you to clean the data. They don't tell you to look for that symptomology. So the people coming out that are going into this space are expecting they're going to do a lot of data cleanse. They're never taught to look for, how do I put proper data controls in place so that my cost of my data governance program is actually reduced? Because if you put the data control in place, let's say you go from an open text to a list of values in a specific data point. Okay, you control the data better, which means that you don't have to put as much governance effort to it to be able to reduce costs long-term.
Yeah.
You're not constantly cleansing, but you're also not constantly governing. And putting that program in the right way with the proper system development, the proper tool evolution is very important to reducing those costs over time.
Yeah, and I will say, having similar conversations to others that are trying to teach this in a very non-traditional way, you know, like we are here, there is a lot of merit to what you're saying, where I think in any educational setting, you most often are not looking at the systems that are generating the data, right? Like, you're just mining from the Twitter feed, or you're mining from Wikidata, or whatever system you're mining the data from. And that's why they're teaching the students, okay, now you got to clean it, because you don't know what happened with that data. But in, you know, in industry, you actually do have the luck where you are most often dealing with the systems as well that are generating that data. So you have a say. It's just, I think, to your point, if you weren't really taught to question that, then you probably won't, at least for a while, until you learn the hard way.
Right. So there's the understanding of what you actually want to do with that data and how you're going to utilize it to enable whatever your end goal is. Mm-hmm. That should drive, am I going to ask all of those elements, or which set am I going to ask?
Yeah, I know that this might be a controversial statement, but I am always of the opinion that gather as much data as possible and to the, you know, as specific as you can early on. And, you know, as long as the data set that you're looking at, for instance, maybe you're doing that for only 5 products, or maybe 5 locations, or 5 people, whatever. I think that gives you an understanding of what is possible. And then you can really see what the behaviors look like. And then you can kind of, you know, pair it back after that. But I always find, if I say, no, we probably don't need that data, I always regret it later. Always.
So, and there's real implications to this. In a previous work environment, we had a special that was coming out on a particular product. So I was working for a retailer at this point. Mm-hmm. And we didn't know about the special, so we were trying to do some data cleansing from a product taxonomy perspective. And we decided we were going to go to all lowercase for our colors. And we did a test on the word white to make sure that everywhere from a drop-down perspective where the word white existed, it was going to have a lowercase w. Mm-hmm. That way our faceting was normalized, everything else was normalized. What we didn't understand was that the link that they had put out in their digital advertising was dependent on the capital W. They had a special going out on the iPad mini that we broke that link because we went to a lowercase w from an uppercase w.
Knowing who else is using your data set is important. But it's only been recently where I've really started to feel it, where, you know, if somebody else has already solved a problem, maybe they've normalized certain people's names, I shouldn't have to do it again. I could just use theirs. So with that, do you have, if you want to impart, you know, your words of wisdom, your last words of wisdom, Dan, I think we'll probably have you on the channel again, but, you know, for now, what would be your imparting wisdom to all of us?
I would say never ignore user interface everything that you do around data has a user interface of some form, whether it's Excel, whether it's an Access database, whether you have a UI on a web server. Never underestimate the ability of people to work around the controls you put in a user interface. If you spend as much time in user interface design as you do in database design, you're probably failing. You should be spending more time worrying about how people are flowing through the data collection mechanisms to ensure that you're getting them empowered with the best data collection mechanism possible before you even worry about how you're going to store the data.
Yeah, that's good. And interface here, you're talking about the users, your internal users, not necessarily an external interface.
Right.
All right. So thank you very much, Dan, for having this little chat with me today. If somebody wanted to get a hold of you and your company to do any data governance, how would they go about doing that?
You can reach me at dan.o'connor, that is O-C-O-N-N-O-R, at verndale.com, or you can go to verndale.com and interact with us there.
And you are also on LinkedIn if anybody wants to go and check you out. All right. So I want to say thank you to Dan for taking time out of his busy day to talk with us about his perspective on data quality. So with that, I will catch you later.